So what makes marriage a mess? Marriage is a mess very simply because it's a human creation. We create our marriages through the creation of thoughts, emotions, and actions. It's a human creation, not a divine creation, not a creation formed by the world, a creation formed by two fallen human beings. And the reason it becomes so destructive is we're using our knowledge. God created the body and the soul, and only His knowledge works correctly with the body and the soul. However, when we ate the forbidden fruit, we attained our own knowledge, and now we think we know how to use the soul and the body to create marriage. And that is what is making a mess. We're also designing marriage in our own knowledge for consumption. So a man wants to be successful when he's not, so he creates the marriage and sets it all up to feed his need to look and feel successful. The woman, on the other hand, wants to be desirable, but she's not. So she designs the marriage to consume and fill herself with these delusions that she's desirable. So both men and women in the fallen world, we design the marriage for something to consume, to fill us with what we don't have. But that, of course, is not what God intended. So marriage is a human creation that we use for consumption. God designed marriage to give, not receive. We were supposed to be filled first as souls, then we'd have all we need to pour forth abundance into our one mind, heart, and body in marriage, and then produce value for the world. So although the problem is human creation, the solution isn't that God should come in and make our marriages. The solution is that we go to Him first as souls, and then we continue creating our marriages as we've always been, but with Him as the source. So how is marriage created? Let's look back at the Garden of Eden and consider what God actually designed. Because if you think about it, He didn't actually create marriage in the Garden of Eden. He created the man and the woman. So to understand what we create and what we call marriage, we need to look at what God designed in the man and the woman. And His instructions were very clear. He said, first, the man leaves his father and mother. Now, if you consider that, you realize the man is creating a separation between him and his family. So the man simplistically can be understood as the one who creates separation. He's not just separating from his family distance-wise, he's separating from his family's idea of marriage. All previous thoughts, emotions, and actions regarding marriage, he's got to separate from them. Why? Because if you're going to create a unique marriage, you need to get rid of all the old stuff and make something new with this woman. Now, there were two parts to God's instructions. First, He said the man will leave his father and mother, and then the next part He says, and be united to his wife. So although the man's really good at separating, he's not really good at uniting. So that's why the woman was created. She cleaves to the man. Why does she do this? Because she was taken from his side. So there's only one place that she belongs, and that's beside the man. So she positions herself so that the man sees her, recognizes, oh, you belong at my side. Then the man separates her from her family too, takes her into him, and then they become one together. So as that relationship builds though, the man keeps separating. He keeps pushing out all their concepts of marriage so that they can create their own concept of marriage, which of course the woman has to oversee as the one creating union. Now as this relationship grows, the couple has to believe that they're truly bringing something valuable into the world, that their marriage is unique. They're learning from God as spiritual souls, but they're not going to create God's marriage, they're going to create their marriage. And they have to believe it's important, they have to believe it's valuable, and that will prompt them to keep separating and uniting simultaneously. So each couple creates their own unique marriage. That's what God wants. You live with Him as souls, and then you use your bodies to express what you've learned, but in your own unique way. You can't recreate the Trinity, but you can create your own expression in your marriage. So why is marriage created? At a fundamental level, we can see that it is to express the Trinity. God made the man and the woman in his likeness. So whatever we are, it's rooted in who he is. And here's where we run into our first problem. We think that we're supposed to directly express the Trinity, do things the way God would do them. But that's silly. We're not God. Furthermore, we have bodies, and God does not. So how are we supposed to be like him exactly when we have bodies? It doesn't make any sense. So you're not supposed to express the Trinity directly. You're not supposed to be the Trinity. You're supposed to put on your own unique interpretation of the Trinity, and that's a unique marriage. So you're going to express not the Trinity directly, you're going to learn from the Trinity, but you're going to express your own union in your own way, and that's why you have free will, and this is a good thing. But you can't really try to express your union because you don't even really know what that is. Your partner's very mysterious to you. You like them, you want to be with them, you want to create with them, but you can't even directly try to express your union. You're really here to express you. God designed you uniquely, and he wants you to express yourself uniquely. And a partnership in marriage is where two souls come together, both of which are unique, and you meld your bodies together, your minds, your hearts, and your physical flesh. You put it all together and you put on an exciting show that's about the Trinity, but it's expressing your unique take. It's your marriage. So your marriage expresses the Trinity, but from your perspective. So who creates marriage then? I know we've been over this, but it is critical to understand that God does not create marriage. He does not enter into a marriage and forcefully bring forth children. He doesn't force thoughts, emotions, and actions. He trusts that you will learn from him and then use your bodies to bring forth thoughts, emotions, and actions, children, relationships, a family, a home. He expects you to do those things. He doesn't do them. He wants to walk with your soul. And he only created the soul to live with him like that. He does not want to create your marriage for you. That's why he made you. And you're very good at creating things, such as marriage. It's also not the world. We like to blame the world, our finances, our upbringing, our parents, her parents, his parents, whatever, their families. We're always blaming other things. But none of those things create your marriage. The only one that creates your marriage is you and your partner. In fact, if any other influence gets in your marriage, that's the responsibility of the man. How did another influence get into your marriage? The man's supposed to be separating from all exterior influences, particularly material influences. No material influence is supposed to have any say in the creation of your marriage. That is fundamental. So you create your marriage. You create your thoughts, emotions, and actions. You create the time you spend with your partners. You're the creator of that. God created your soul and your body, and you used your soul and your body with your partner to create your marriage. So it's important to understand that any outside influence inhibits the creation of a unique marriage. And you want a unique marriage. God designed you to create a unique marriage. So you must keep any outside material influences from having any impact on your marriage. However, there is one influence that God does want remaining in your marriage. Not a material influence, a spiritual one. And that is himself. He wants to walk with the souls of you and your partner, and then he expects you and your partner to go forth and create your own unique marriage.